ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
हरे कृष्ण। वेलकम टू भागवत प्रवाह ऑनलाइन कोर्स। In the last 67 episodes, we have covered 11 cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam, and today we will begin the 12th canto, the last canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And we will cover 12th canto in 3 episodes. 12th canto has 13 chapters, and of all the 10 topics of Srimad Bhagavatam, 12th canto would focus mainly on the topic of Nirodha, or the destruction, or universal annihilation. So there are 4 types of annihilation that are described in the 12th canto. So we will cover them in today's episode only. So there are 10 topics in Srimad Bhagavatam. Atra sargo visargascha sthanam poshanam mutayah manvantara ishanukatha nirodho muktirashrayah. So we have seen sarga and visarga in the initial cantos. So like third canto focuses mainly on sarga, and some sarga is described in the second canto also. Then visarga begins from the middle of third canto. And entire fourth canto is dedicated to Visarga, and then fifth canto first half is also Visarga. Then fifth canto second half discusses sthanam, or the positioning of various living entities in different planets of the universe. And sixth canto describes poshanam. Poshanam is protection offered by the Supreme Lord. Then seventh canto describes uti, means the inclination of people in this world. Then eighth canto focuses on manvantara. There are 14 manvantaras in one day of Brahma, and 8th canto elaborates on all of them. And 9th canto focuses on Ishanukatha. Then 10th canto, Ashraya. Ashraya means supreme shelter. The supreme shelter is the Supreme Lord Krishna, and Krishna's pastimes right from his birth till towards the later pastimes, everything is described in the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And in the 11th canto of Bhagavatam, the predominant topics that is discussed is Mukti. Through the conversations between Nimi and Namayogindra, and Krishna and Uddhava, that is Uddhava Gita. So through these two main conversations, 11th canto presents the topic of Mukti. So the 12th canto now is describing the topic of Nirodha. Nirodha means annihilation. So although all these 10 topics are present in all 12 cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam, according to Jiva Goswami, still some cantos focus mainly on a particular topic. So these 10 topics are covered in 12 cantos of Bhagavatam with various degrees of emphasis. So for example, 8th canto predominantly emphasizes on manvantara, while 6th canto predominantly emphasizes on poshanam, etc., etc. So now today we will begin the 12th canto of Bhagavatam, and we will cover the first 6 chapters of 12th canto out of 13 chapters. 6th chapter also we will cover up to half, and tomorrow we will begin from the middle of the 6th chapter. So, because 6th chapter first half describes the departure of Parikshit Maharaj. In this today's episode, based on this first six chapters, we will discuss the symptoms of Kali Yuga, the dynasties of Kali Yuga, and the activities of Kalki Avatar, and the 4 types of destruction or pralaya, and we will also discuss the departure of Parikshit Maharaj. He will go back to Godhead, and Sukadeva Goswami concludes his narration. So these are the topics that we will be discussing today. And in the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Sukadeva Goswami described the disappearance of the Supreme Lord Krishna and the Yadu dynasty. So after Krishna departed from this material world, Kali Yuga began. Kali Yuga started exerting its influence. So having described Krishna's departure in the 11th canto, Sukadeva Goswami begins the description of Kali Yuga in the 12th canto. So also 12th canto describes 4 types of destruction, while the 10th and 11th cantos are describing Krishna's pastimes. So, to focus on the pastimes of the Supreme Lord Krishna, we need to develop detachment from this material world. The destruction of this material world, the 4 types of destructions that happen in this material universe are described very elaborately in the 12th canto, and by reading these descriptions, we can develop detachment from this material existence, knowing that ultimately everything is going to be destroyed. So we need to be attached to the Supreme Lord Krishna only. So that's the conclusion that one should arrive at after reading through these descriptions. Now we will start the first chapter of 12th canto. The first chapter of 12th canto describes the dynasties of Kali Yuga. So Sukadeva Goswami begins with Puranjaya, and then in this lineage there is Brihadvartha, then Jarasandha, then Sahadeva. There are so many different kings in Kali Yuga. So only the names of all these kings are mentioned. You can see in that big chart. So there are several names and tens of names are mentioned. So these are all various kings in Kali Yuga. And the end of this chapter, the last few slokas of this chapter describe the qualities of these kings. So in Kali Yuga, the kings or rulers are barbarians actually in the disguise of kings. They don't have good qualities. They don't have patience or tolerance or selflessness or responsibility towards the citizens. They even trouble innocent citizens. They cannot take care of citizens properly, and they are short-lived. They cannot follow the Vedic rituals. They are not purified sufficiently by following the Vedic prescriptions and avoiding Vedic prohibitions. And they are covered with lower modes of passion and ignorance. So these are the qualities of the kings in Kali Yuga in general. There are some noble kings, but still there are many bad kings. And this Sukadeva Goswami even predicts some popular personalities that are going to appear in Kali Yuga. So Sukadeva Goswami spoke Srimad Bhagavatam, or Vyasadeva has written Srimad Bhagavatam more than 5000 years back. So the names like Chanakya, Chandragupta, and few other names that we know popularly in Kali Yuga, they were already written in Srimad Bhagavatam 5000 years back. So these Puranas written by Vyasadeva or spoken by Sukadeva Goswami, so they predict the future also. So just as we have seen in the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Sukadeva Goswami spoke about the 14 manvantaras in this day of Brahma. Only 6 manvantaras have passed. We are currently in the middle of 7th manvantara, and in future there are 8 manvantaras. But Sukadeva Goswami gave a description of all these 14 manvantaras, past, present and future. So that's the power of Srimad Bhagavatam, that can predict future also. And in Kali Yuga, the future kings are going to be very low in their character. And if kings, rulers who are supposed to set the right example for common people to follow, if the such kings are not having proper character, you can only imagine what would be the character of common people or citizens. So in Kali Yuga, citizens would imitate the character and behavior and speech of rulers. They are harassed by the leaders, and they are harassed by each other also, because truthfulness and cleanliness will diminish. So in the second chapter of 12th canto, Sukadeva Goswami further describes the qualities of Kali Yuga, the degraded symptoms of Kali Yuga. So in Kali Yuga, dharma will diminish. Truthfulness, cleanliness, tolerance, mercy, lifespan, and physical strength and memory are diminished in Kali Yuga day by day. So in the previous yugas, people used to hear something, and without making a note of it in writing, they can remember. Such people are called Shrutidhars. People used to have great mental strength and physical strength and memory and self-control, mind control. But all these qualities will diminish as Kali Yuga progresses. And law and justice will be applied only on the basis of one's power. A person who has more physical strength or influence in public, or who has a lot of wealth, he is considered a great man. But ideally, the person who has good character should be considered a great man. One who has good knowledge, he should be considered a great man. But just based on some external abilities like physical strength or wealth, Kali Yuga people are considered great people. And a man will be considered as a Brahmana just by wearing a thread. Or success in business happens only by cheating and deceit. Okay, and a person's property will be seriously questioned if he's not a person who earns money in a rightful manner. So people will just do word jugglery, and they're accepted as great scholars in Kali Yuga. So what is good and what is bad, what is auspicious, what is inauspicious, what is pure, what is impure, what is piety, what is sin. That discrimination is lost in Kali Yuga gradually. As the years progress, so people lose the discriminatory power also. Good is not accepted as good. Bad will be accepted as good. So that's the nature of Kali Yuga as it progresses more and more. Hypocrisy or duplicity is considered a virtue in Kali Yuga sometimes, and marriages will be arranged just by verbal agreement and just by attraction between man and woman physically, with physical beauty. So without proper ties based on Vedic customs and scriptural prescriptions. And beauty is considered to be good hairstyle, and filling belly becomes goal of life for Kali Yuga people. If someone can earn money and then maintain his family and earn for his livelihood, he is considered a very successful man. Although that has to happen just as a matter of duty, while spiritual progress is seen as priority in human society, in Kali Yuga it becomes opposite. Just earning livelihood and maintaining family is considered a great thing. So he who can maintain a family is considered to be very expert person. In Kali Yuga, not only qualities are diminished, there are many other sufferings because of natural calamities, and one's own body and mind will trouble. The body will become weak. In Kali Yuga, people do not have sufficient physical strength and mental strength, and even thieves also are considered rulers. The rulers will accept positions as rulers or kings with a lot of greed for money, just to exploit people, just to accumulate wealth for selfish purposes. And people are harassed by famine, and they resort to eating leaves and roots and flesh and wild honey, fruits, flowers and seeds. They do not have ability to produce food or eat food properly, eat healthy food. Food also will be polluted with so many contaminated substances, and people suffer from extreme heat and cold and rain and snow and wind, and lifespan is restricted to 100 years, and as Kali Yuga progresses, it can reduce. It will become a person who lives for 100 years is very rare as Kali Yuga progresses, and it could come up to as low as 50 years also as Kali Yuga progresses. And the size of cows will reduce. They look like goats. And spiritual hermitages will become like mundane houses, and no joint families will exist in Kali Yuga as it progresses. Already we have been seeing certain symptoms of Kali Yuga. Although only 5,000 years of Kali Yuga passed, there are 4,23,000 years more. We can only imagine how much more degradation can happen in future. So just within the first few thousands of years only Kali Yuga, we are able to see a lot of degradation. Just within one generation only, we are able to see a lot of diminution of sensual strength and physical strength. So as Kali Yuga progresses, this degradation happens even at a faster pace. And at the end of Kali Yuga, to restore Dharma, the Supreme Personality of Godhead will come in the form of Kalki Avatar, on a beautiful horse with a sword in hand. So at that time, the adharma is so rampant, and people do not have the capacity to hear some spiritual knowledge and understand. People will lose that capacity to hear or understand or assimilate or imbibe the spiritual values in one's life. So in Kali Yuga, the Supreme Lord comes in the form of Kalki and then chops off the heads of all such miscreants and bring a transformation in this whole earthly ambience, and he will bring about the transformation from Kali Yuga to next Satya Yuga. So Kali Yuga is the most degraded age, Satya Yuga is the most elevated age. So to bring this transformation, the Supreme Lord personally has to come. So he will chop off all the miscreants, and he will bring about great change in the atmosphere and the minds of people also by his personal presence. From the fragrance emanating from Lord Kalki's body, there will be transformation in the entire atmosphere of Kali Yuga, in the whole climate, and also there will be transformation within the minds of materialistic people, and they will start behaving in a good manner. So then next Satyuga will begin after the end of this Kali Yuga. So, but we are in the beginning stages of Kali Yuga only. And when Lord Kalki appears, he will be born as a Brahmana to a father named Vishnu Yesha in Sambhala village. The place of birth and the family of birth are also predicted how Kalki is going to come. So, actually scriptures predict the appearances of the Supreme Lord, future appearances of the Supreme Lord also. So then the minds of people will become transcendentally pure with the presence of the Lord. And that's how the next Satyayuga will begin. So people will imbibe the qualities of mode of goodness because of the presence of Kalki, avatar. So after this, Sukadeva Goswami describes that the Lord re-establishes the religion towards the end of this chapter, Sukadeva Goswami says that this sloka comes. Krimivit bhasma samnyate raja namno api yasyacham bhutadruktat krute svartham kimvedanirayo yataha. So, the body which is meant to be eaten by krimivit bhasma. So, body is eaten by krimi, means some insects when it is buried in the ground, when it is dead. Or sometimes the dead body is burnt in fire, it will become ashes. Krimi, weed. Or the dead body is just abandoned, some jackals or some wild animals may eat that flesh of the dead body, then it will become stool. So the destination of this material body is to become food for worms or insects, or stool of vultures and jackals, or ashes. So that's the destination of this material body. But Kali Yuga people are very much attached to this material body, maintaining this material body, and forget that they are spirit souls, and forget the activities that they are supposed to do as spiritual beings. But they are absorbed in their identities as material bodies, and they do everything to make this body comfortable, to enjoy in a bodily plane. And even kings and rulers are also like that in Kali Yuga. So, Sukadeva Goswami in this context describes a song sung by Mother Earth. The song is called Bhumi Gita. So, understanding the nature of Kali Yuga kings, Mother Earth undergoes a lot of pain. She is unable to tolerate the sin and the negative qualities of all these kings who were ruling her surface. So, all these kings think that I am the ruler of earth. I am the ruler of this land. So, Mother Earth has seen so many kings like that. So many people claimed proprietorship over Mother Earth in various ways at different phases of time. But all these people just passed. In the beginning of our today's session, we have seen one big slide where the names of so many kings are there. So, they just remain names. All these people appeared on this earth and they ruled this earth for some time, a portion of that earth for some time, and they passed away. So they come and they go. Mother Earth has seen so many such kings who unnecessarily claimed proprietorship over her and who unnecessarily fought with other kings and expanded their kingdom, but they could not rule her for forever, whether they are good kings or bad kings. So they cannot become the masters of earth for a long time. So Mother Earth is singing this song called Bhumi Gita with such great concern. In the first shloka she says, the kings are playthings in the hands of death, but they desire to conquer me. So when a king is fighting with other kings and trying to defeat those kings and take their kingdoms into his kingdom, basically the king is greedy for accumulating more land and claiming proprietorship over Mother Earth. So that's the that's what the king is trying to do. So Mother Earth is thinking like that. So these people are just mere toys in the hands of death, and they place hope on their material body, and they meet frustration and failure, and whatever success they have is like fleeting bubble on the foams of water. So when the water has a lot of foam, there are so many bubbles that form. How long that bubble will stay? That's how our material life is also temporary. So, when we get this human body, we are supposed to understand that this human form of life is also temporary. I should be utilizing this human form of life to cultivate spiritual knowledge and to perform various spiritual activities and come closer to God and give up this material existence. That is supposed to be the ideal aspiration. And Mother Bhumi says that all these kings imagine to be my masters, and they think that I will conquer my mind and senses, I will conquer my ministers and advisors and citizens and friends and relatives. You can see that picture. And I will conquer entire earth. Basically, every ruler, every king, generally, they try to just expand their influence and accumulate more and more land and become masters of earth for as much duration as possible, for as much area as possible. That's the attempt of a typical king, typical materialistic king. Mother Earth is thinking like this. And after conquering land, they want to encroach upon the seas also. They will just go inside the sea, they will explore the fishes, and they will also try to collect some gems and other pearls within the water. So they want to conquer mountains, they want to conquer seas also. Many great men have come and they left this world helplessly. Although a person is very influential and powerful, that person, that king, cannot stay on this earth's surface for a long time. So materialistic people will fight with one another, and even children will fight with, sons will fight with father, and father might fight with son. When the father dies, the son immediately wants to accumulate or usurp all the property of father. And when son dies, the father also sometimes wants to accumulate the property of son, whatever the son has earned. So that greed is there within the minds of materialistic people. So instead of considering themselves as caretakers of the family on behalf of God and living life in a Krishna conscious way, some materialistic family members, they may consider themselves as proprietors of whatever they have, whatever they earn, and they continue with that false identities as masters and proprietors. They think that this property is mine forever, but the life itself is temporary. Yes, one should earn their livelihood or some property in honest means and then take care of it for one's own maintenance, but that does not mean that one considers oneself as artificial proprietor of everything that one pursues. And one should not assume that everything that I earn will stay with me forever, eternally. That doesn't happen. So one should pursue one's spiritual goals also. So political leaders challenge one another. And the fate of these kings is that even though they are great kings, sometimes they are very great demons, or sometimes they are very knowledgeable or heroic and conquering, unconquerable. Still, their attempts to possess Mother Earth will be futile. So even if they happen to become kings for a while, one day they have to die. No one can rule the earth perpetually for the rest of eternity. So not knowing that their positions are temporary, they become attached to such artificial and temporary positions. And ultimate purpose of narrating about all these kings is to teach us jnana and vijnana and vairagya. So why Sukadeva Goswami towards the end of Srimad Bhagavatam is presenting all this about Kali Yuga kings and the qualities of kings and the Bhumi Gita? The purpose of this whole description of Kali Yuga and all that is to induce knowledge in all of us, to induce detachment in all of us. So knowing that everything is temporary in this material world, we should get detached. Sometimes we may hear about Krishna, we may get attracted also, but our attraction towards this material enjoyment still continues sometimes. So we need to discuss both about Supreme Lord's sweet pastimes that are described in the 10th canto and 11th canto also. And we should also understand the temporary nature of this material world as described in 12th canto also, and develop detachment. So detachment from matter and attachment to the Supreme Lord, so both should go simultaneously. So if one desires bhakti, one should hear Krishna katha constantly. So here positive things about the Supreme Lord Krishna and also understand the futility of material happiness and temporary nature of this material world and this progress in spiritual life. And Parikshit Maharaj asked Sukadeva Goswami after hearing this Bhumi Gita. Parikshit asked, "Oh my dear Sukadeva Goswami, how can these Kali Yuga people rid themselves of this contamination?" Now Parikshit Maharaj has already heard 11 cantos and he is hearing 12th canto, last canto, in just very little time, in just few more minutes probably, he is going back to Godhead. But Parikshit is asking with great concern, Kali Yuga people are so contaminated, so degraded, how can they relieve themselves of this contamination? So, then Sukadeva goes, and you also speak to me about the qualities of different yugas. Then Sukadeva Goswami will now speak about the qualities of Satya Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, Trita Yuga and Kali Yuga and the process of deliverance or liberation within Kali Yuga also. So this is a very interesting description. So now in the 18th sloka onwards, Sukadeva Goswami begins the description of different yugas. So first, Satya Yuga. In Satya Yuga, people have the qualities of truthfulness and dharma. Dharma used to stand on four legs. Tapaha, satyam, daya, saucham. Tapa means austerity. Satyam means truthfulness. Daya means compassion. Saucham means cleanliness. So these four qualities are there in Satya Yuga people, and dharma stands on these four legs completely, firmly. But as yugas progress, this dharma will reduce. So in Satya Yuga, people are very truthful. And the qualities of people are, they are self-satisfied, they are merciful, they are friendly, they are peaceful, they are very tolerant and sober. And they see all things equally. And the mind and intelligence are fixed in mode of goodness in Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga people are predominantly in mode of goodness. Now, Treta Yuga, the qualities of Treta Yuga are that each leg of religion is gradually reduced by one quarter. So, tapaha, satyam, daya, saucham are 100% there in Kali Yuga, they become 75% when it comes to Treta Yuga. Then people are devoted to ritualistic performances and they are not very violent or very lusty, but interested in Trivargas, dharma, artha, kamas. So like that, the qualities of people will slightly reduce when it comes to Treta Yuga. And people function predominantly in mode of passion in Treta Yuga. When it comes to Dwapara Yuga, the qualities of this Satya, Daya, Tapaha, Saucham, these things will reduce by 50%. People will just have dissatisfaction, they are untruthful, they are violent and envious. That all these qualities will creep in Dwapara Yuga a lot. So, then effects of passion and ignorance will overwhelm people in Treta Yuga, sorry, in Dwapara Yuga. In Kali Yuga, all these four principles of dharma, tapaha, saucham, daya, satyam, they will reduce by 75%. Only 25% of these qualities exist in Kali Yuga. So people are very greedy, ill-behaved, merciless, quarrel with other people without any reason. They are unfortunate, they are obsessed with so many material desires. So in this Kali Yuga, ignorance is very predominant, the mode of ignorance. So people are cheating, they lie, they are sleepy, they are violent, depression, lamentation, bewilderment, fear, poverty are predominant in Kali Yuga. So generally Kali Yuga people are very short-sighted and unfortunate and lustful and poverty-stricken, and chastity is lost, loyalty is lost, and cities are dominated by thieves, and Vedas are contaminated by speculation. Instead of accepting the Vedic knowledge as it is, people speculate and then impose their own conceptions on the Vedas. And there are some people who just reject Vedas only. That's the nature of Kali Yuga. And political leaders could consume the citizens by extracting a lot of wealth from them and taxes from them. So as Kali Yuga progresses, all these things will manifest. And about ashramas, in Kali Yuga, Varnashram Dharma is not very effectively implemented. So brahmacharis, who are supposed to be very clean and obedient to Guru, they become unclean and they don't follow any vows as Kali Yuga progresses. And householders, they could become like beggars. And vanaprasthas, they live in villages. Sannyasis, they become greedy. Sannyasi is supposed to be very detached, but in Kali Yuga, sannyasis also become very greedy. So now, in the initial stages of Kali Yuga, these symptoms may not be very vividly manifest, although we are able to see them here and there. But as Kali Yuga progresses, they will become more and more prominent. And the degraded qualities of Kali Yuga people are further described. So business is done just to cheat people. So accumulate lot of wealth. And servants abandon a master when he becomes poor. And masters may abandon servants when even when the servant is loyal. So there is no truthfulness or value for relationships in Kali Yuga. So men are controlled by the opposite gender a lot. So uncultured men earn their livelihood by just begging on behalf of Lord. They present themselves as spiritual personalities and then showing some spiritual symbols, they beg money for their own personal maintenance, and they use it for sense gratification also sometimes. And even though people are ignorant of dharma or spiritual principles, they speak on spiritual principles, although they don't know much. So other degraded qualities of Kali Yuga, our mind is always agitated and disturbed by fear. So people could appear very ghostly or hunted, and people could develop hatred just over few coins. Even there could be deep enmity amongst family members and brothers and sisters, parents and children also, just because they want money. They are greedy for money. People just want to satisfy their own senses and bellies and genitals. Now, what is the solution for such degraded people of Kali Yuga? So how can they be delivered? Sukadeva Goswami begins his narration now about the process of deliverance in Kali Yuga. In the 44th shloka, he says, Yannamadheyam riyamana aturaha patanskhalanva vivashogranan puman vimukta karma gala uttamam gatim prapnoti yakshyantina tam kalau janaha. So in Kali Yuga, even unconscious utterance of the holy name of the Supreme Lord Krishna can deliver a person from this material existence. That does not mean that one has to chant the holy names of the Lord unconsciously, but if unconscious utterance of Krishna's name can give so much of pleasure and deliver a person from material existence, what to speak of consciously chanting the names of the Lord with faith and devotion and concentration. So the Lord can remove all contamination from the life of a person who fixes one's mind on him. So even accidentally, you can see the example of Kali Yuga of Ajamil. Ajamil chanted the holy name of Narayana just to indicate his son. But the Vishnudutas came and protected Ajamil from the ropes of Yamadutas. So that's the nature of the holy name of the Lord. Holy name is very merciful. And especially in Kali Yuga, one can be delivered from this material existence by taking shelter of the holy name of the Supreme Lord Krishna. So in the 46th shloka, Sukadeva Goswami says, Shrutaha sankirtito dhyataha pujitaha chadrito piva nranam dhunoti bhagavan hrutstho janmayuta shubham. So he says that if a person shrutaha, he hears about Krishna, sankirtito, he chants the glories of Krishna, or then chants the holy name, or narrates Krishna's pastimes. Dhyataha means when he meditates on the Lord. Pujitaha means when he worships the Lord, as you see in that picture. So whatever you do, all the spiritual activities, hearing or chanting or worshipping or simply offering respects to him, all the contamination in the mind will be removed to the degree we do all these activities sincerely. And as fire purifies gold, the Supreme Lord Vishnu purifies our minds. So we should meditate on Vishnu only. So this process of meditating on the Lord and chanting the holy names of the Lord is very effective. And especially in Kali Yuga, we need to take shelter of the holy names of the Lord only. And further, the potency of the holy name is elaborated. So one has to endeavor to fix one's mind on the Supreme Lord Keshava and attain the supreme destination. The Supreme Lord is the ultimate controller and supreme shelter of all beings. When one meditates on the Lord at the time of death, one can attain one's original spiritual identity. So there are unlimited faults in Kali Yuga, but we can be relieved of all those faults, all those anarthas or shortcomings by taking shelter of holy name. So that's why in the 51st shloka, which is very popular shloka, Sukadeva Goswami says, Kaler dosha nidhe rajan astihye ko mahan gunah kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sangah param vrajet. Kaler dosha nidhe rajan. Kali Yuga is dosha nidhi, is a treasure house, or is a storehouse of all kinds of faults. Kaler dosha nidhe rajan astihi eko mahan gunah. But there is one good quality in Kali Yuga. What is that? Kirtanat eva krishnasya. Just by doing kirtan of Krishna's holy names, just by chanting or singing, both are fine, chanting or singing the holy names of Krishna, mukta sangaha param vrajet. One can be relieved of material attachments, and param vrajet, one can go to the spiritual abode of the Supreme Lord Krishna also. So that's why Kali Yuga, although it is filled with faults, it's very great yuga to take birth in. Even the people of other yugas also aspire to take birth in Kali Yuga, because the process of liberation in Kali Yuga is easier compared to other yugas. Very important shloka, 52nd shloka. Sukadeva Goswami says, Krite yadhyayato vishnum tretayam yajato makhaihi dvapare paricharyayam kalau tadhari kirtanat. Krite yadhyayato vishnum. In Krita Yuga or Satya Yuga, people meditate on the Supreme Lord Vishnu. So meditation is the process of liberation. Krite yadhyayato vishnu tretayam yajato makhaihi. In Treta Yuga, people perform sacrifices for deliverance. And Dvapare Paricharyayam, in Dvapara Yuga, people worship the Lord like a king. It's like a great deity worship. And Kalauta Dhari Kirtanat, whatever you attain by meditation in Satya Yuga, or by sacrificing in Treta Yuga, and by Paricharya, means by rendering deity worship in Dwapara Yuga, you can attain all these results in Kali Yuga by chanting the holy names of Krishna. So, Kalau Tad Hari Kirtanat, by doing Hari Kirtan, one can attain all the results of the processes of previous yugas also. So, that's the potency of the holy name of Krishna. And especially in Kali Yuga, we have to take shelter of holy names only, because we don't have the ability to do the other things. Like we cannot be sitting and meditating for such a long time. In Krita Yuga, people used to meditate for thousands of years. They may meditate for 10,000 years or 20,000 years or 60,000 years, because they have such a long lifespan and they have such concentration. They will not be deviated. They have self-control. Their bodies are strong. The climate is strong. The climate is very clean. It's not polluted with lot of pollution or gases. And the climate is extremely conducive for spiritual advancement also. Materialism is not very rampant. So, but the process of deliverance is meditation, which is quite difficult for a Kali Yuga person. And we cannot have so many sacrifices. We may not even gathers necessary ingredients for sacrifices also in Kali Yuga. And elaborate deity worship also is not possible. So we definitely do deity worship as a part of our Bhakti Yoga, even in Kali Yuga also. But the extent to which a Dwapara Yuga person can worship is not possible for a Kali Yuga person. So in Kali Yuga, by doing Hari Kirtana, by chanting the holy names of the Supreme Lord Krishna or Hari, so one can be delivered. So that's why the people of previous ages also desire to take birth in Kali Yuga, because the means of deliverance in Kali Yuga is very easy. So in Kali Yuga, if we just chant the holy names of the Lord, we can easily go back to Godhead. But doing so many thousands of years of meditation in Kriti Yuga is very difficult. Sacrifices are difficult and worship is difficult. But chanting is easy compared to all the other three. So people of previous Yugas desire to take birth in Kali Yuga, and that too in Kali Yuga lifespan is very less, hardly 100 years. In previous Yugas, it's 1000 years or 10,000 years or 1 lakh years. People used to live for such a long time. Lord Ramachandra ruled for 13,000 years. So like that. And Prachetas did meditation just 10,000 years. Just before even they entered household life and accepted the role of kings, they did 10,000 years of tapasya underwaters as just their training phase. So to that degree, people have long lifespan in the previous Yugas. But in Kali Yuga, just 100 years. Only 100 years. What is 100 years in comparison to such big numbers of previous Yugas? So just in 100 years lifespan, if one can chant the holy names of the Lord, one can easily be delivered. And another important aspect, the Kali Yuga people, because they are intellectually very poor, they are mentally very distracted, they don't have good mind control or sense control, what they eat is not pure in nature, what they see is not very pure in nature or auspicious in nature, and the lifespan is less, they are quite desperate to take shelter of the holy names of the Lord. And they can't do anything beyond this also. But in the previous ages, people may not take shelter of the holy names of the Lord as desperately as a Kali Yuga person does. Because they have so much of physical strength and mental strength and concentration, meditation and chanting mantras, this and that, they consider that just by chanting the holy name of the Lord, Krishna, Rama, Hare, just by chanting these holy names, I will go back to Godhead. It may not be so easy. I should do something more complicated, more elaborate. So they may not even consider the process of chanting the holy names of the Lord, such a simple method, to be a means of deliverance also, because of their advanced intelligence and advanced powers. So, but Kali Yuga person is very desperate to chant the holy names. Kali Yuga person who desires liberation, who does not have the ability to do anything else, he can take desperately the shelter of the holy names. That desperation is not seen in the people of previous Yugas. Thus, to be born as a human being in Kali Yuga and be connected to a proper bona fide Vaishnava Sampradaya and chant the holy names of the Lord and Sri and hear Srimad Bhagavatam is the greatest fortune that we can imagine in Kali Yuga. So one who has access to this, if he utilizes these facilities properly, it is sure that one can go back to Godhead in Kali Yuga in such a short period of time. But in the previous Yugas, it's very difficult. People, because they are so elevated in their physical and mental internal abilities, they may consider this chanting to be too simple a method for them. They can do much more. Why I should chant only this one mantra, Hare Krishna Maha Mantra? It's very simple. I can memorize some 100 pages of elaborate mantras, Sanskrit mantras, in just one hearing, and I can do all that. Maybe I should do a lot for liberation. This one mantra may not be sufficient. People may think like that in the previous Yugas, but Kali Yuga people, they are more desperate. So they have better opportunity. So that completes the third chapter. We will enter the fourth chapter now. In the fourth chapter, Sukadeva Goswami describes four kinds of pralaya. Pralaya means destruction or annihilation, devastation. So there are four types of pralaya. You can see the chart. One is naimittika pralaya, or occasional annihilation that happens at the end of Brahma's day. Every day of Brahma ends with a annihilation. That is called naimittika or occasional destruction. Then prakritika pralaya or elemental annihilation is complete destruction of the entire material universe that happens at the end of Brahma's life. And atyantika pralaya or ultimate annihilation is annihilation that happens when the false ego of the jiva is destroyed. So while prakritika pralaya and naimittika pralaya are for the entire universe, this atyantika pralaya is only for one particular jiva. Then nitya pralaya means constant pralaya. Constant destruction happens at every moment. So we will discuss all this in little more detail now. So now we will begin with naimittika pralaya or occasional annihilation. So this occasional annihilation or naimittika pralaya happens at the end of day of Brahma. So in the beginning of the day of Brahma, all the planetary systems are manifested and all the species are created. All the planets are populated with different living entities. And manvantaras begin. So like that, there are 14 manvantaras in Brahma's one day. So like that, Brahma lives for 100 years. So now, during the there are 1,000 Divya Yugas within one day of Brahma, and these 1,000 Divya Yugas are ruled by 14 Manus. So around 71 to 72 Divya Yugas each Manu. So 1,000 Divya Yugas are there. So this is the duration of Brahma's one day, and same is the duration of Brahma's night also. So at the end of Brahma's day, entire the whatever planets are there within the material universe, within one universe, are wound up, and they all merge into Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu's body. So Lord Narayana, Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu, would lie down on Anantasesha's body, Anantasesha bed, and he is absorbed in his yoga nidra, and he absorbs the entire universe, means all the details within the universe, into his body, and Brahmaji goes to sleep. So at the end of the lifetime, lifetime of Brahma, this prakritika annihilation or elemental annihilation happens. So this occasional annihilation or naimittika pralaya happens within one universe, and this elemental annihilation or prakritika pralaya happens for the entire universe. So entire universe manifested from Mahavishnu's body, and Mahavishnu expanded himself as Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu and entered each universe. So within the universe, at the end of Brahma's one day, the planets and other details in the universe will merge into Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu's body. At the end of Brahma's life of 100 years, the entire universe merges into Mahavishnu's body. So prakritika annihilation happens when universe enters Mahavishnu, and naimittika annihilation happens when universal elements within one universe enter Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu's body. So it's very small annihilation, that naimittika annihilation, but prakritika pralaya is very elaborate. So now preparations for this annihilation. At the end of the life of Brahma, there will be no rains for 100 years. People will starve. They consume each other also sometimes. The sun will drink up all waters of the ocean, and the fire emanates from Sankarsana's mouth and burns the entire material planets. So in this way, multicolored clouds will come, there will be drought, there will be flood. So like that, all the elements will just merge into their previous sources. Now, how does the creation happen? You can see the creation chart once again. From Mahavishnu's body, the jivas, Mahavishnu injects the jivas into the material universe when the universe comes out of his body in the form of a seed now in the beginning, pradhana. And that pradhana transforms into mahatattva, mahatattva transforms into ahankara, ahankara in the three material modes gives rise to different elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether. So now first sound manifests. From sound ether comes. From ether the element of touch will come. The sense object of touch will come. From touch, air will manifest. From air, form will manifest. From form, fire will manifest. We have discussed all this in the second canto. So, the process of destruction happens in the reverse manner. So, the elements begin to manifest from sound, and then the last element that manifests is earth. Now, earth element merges into smell, and smell will go into water. Then water goes into fire, fire goes into air, air goes into ether. So like that, all these elements will just merge into their previous sources. That's how the entire universe is wound up. We discussed this in Uddhava Gita also, so I will not be repeating all that. But the process of annihilation of the universe is just opposite to the process of the creation of the universe. Just everything goes in reverse manner. So that is Prakritika and Pralaya. So we have discussed two pralayas. One is Naimittika Pralaya that happens at the end of Brahma's day. And second is Prakritika Pralaya that happens at the end of life of Brahma. Now, third pralaya is Atyantika Pralaya or ultimate annihilation. So this annihilation happens when the false ego of the jiva is destroyed. We get this material body, we live in this material world, in this material universe undergoing repeated cycle of birth and death only because of our false ego. False ego is identifying oneself with a false identity. As a man or a woman or an Indian or an American or as a human being or an animal or a bird or a demigod. So that bodily identification is the false ego. So when the false ego of the jiva is destroyed, then this person, the living entity, need not stay in the material world. Because the jiva is not identifying with any material identity anymore. So the jiva is liberated. So basically, this Atyantika Pralaya is equivalent to liberation of jiva. Atyantika Pralaya is nothing but liberation of jiva. That is ultimate annihilation. This happens on an individual basis. So when Naimittika Pralaya happens, entire universe is destroyed. Means all the planetary systems within the universe are destroyed. And when Prakritika Pralaya happens, entire universe merges back into Mahavishnu's body, entire universe is wound up. But Atyantika Pralaya or ultimate destruction happens for every individual living entity. Means that is the destruction of the material life of the conditioned soul. He will become a liberated soul. So that's one thing. And the fourth kind of pralaya is Nitya Pralaya. Nitya Pralaya means constant annihilation. Means at every moment some destruction is happening. Means you put a flower here today and tomorrow you come and see that flower. That flower will not remain fresh. 24 hours passed, that flower will not remain fresh. It will wither and you come and see day after tomorrow. Then it will become brown and then it will become powder also after a couple of days. So we need to understand that destruction is happening to all material objects at every moment. We may not be noticing that destruction moment by moment. If you keep on watching that flower, 1 hour you may watch, you may not find any difference. But we can see the difference at intervals of time. So now you saw it now, constantly you are watching, moment by moment you may not find that there is some change happening. But you see it now and see after four hours, after 5 hours you see. Then you can see a significant change. You click a photo now and from the same angle you click a photo after 4 hours, then the flower will change. After 1 day, the flower will change even more. Then it will be completely destroyed. So that is Nitya Pralaya. So constant deterioration is happening for all material objects and our material body is also deteriorating constantly. So the hairs that are black will not remain black throughout the life. They will become grey, they will become white, and the person who has very soft skin will not remain soft for long. The skin will have wrinkles. So the body will deteriorate. The shakti, the energy of the body will deteriorate towards the old age. Initially it seems growing and after that it destroys. So there is growth and there is destruction also. So constant destruction is happening to all material elements. Although there is some little phase of growth, but the growth is followed by deterioration or destruction also. That is called Nitya Pralaya, constant annihilation. So in this way, Sukadeva Goswami described various aspects of universal destruction and other symptoms of Kali Yuga and Bhumi Gita, all these topics to Parikshit Maharaj. So then Sukadeva Goswami says that, I have briefly narrated the Supreme Lord Narayana's pastimes through his material energy. So even Brahma is not capable of completely describing them, but I just tried my best. Sukadeva Goswami says this. So cultivating taste for hearing these pastimes is the only boat to cross over this material ocean. So you understand how the Supreme Lord functions, what are his sweet pastimes, and how does he deal with this material world, material energy, and develop detachment from that material world. And you discuss his spiritual pastimes and develop attachment towards the spiritual aspects of the Lord. So in this way, by hearing Krishna Katha constantly and hearing a description of Krishna's energies, one can come closer to the Lord. So then, in the fifth chapter of 12th canto, Sukadeva Goswami describes that bhakti is the king of all knowledge and king of all secrets. We have seen Rajavidya, Rajaguhyam, Pavitram Idam Uttamam. So Sukadeva Goswami says that I have elaborately described Hari Katha, and now you understand that he gives the knowledge of spirit soul again. Basically, Sukadeva Goswami is giving some jnana now. So although he has spoken a lot about bhakti, now he will just, towards the end of his teachings to Sukadeva Parikshit Maharaj, Sukadeva Goswami describes some little jnana. It's in the last chapter now. So to think that one is going to die is animalistic mentality. Just now, Sukadeva Goswami described four types of pralaya, four types of destruction. Why he spoke like this? Because Sukadeva Goswami understands that Parikshit Maharaj is going to die now. Because the 7 days duration that he had is completed. So, he is in the last moments of his life. So, according to the curse of Sringi, the Takshaka, the snake bird, will come and bite Parikshit Maharaj within few moments. And Sukadeva Goswami understands that. He began describing Bhagavatam to Sukadeva Goswami 1 week back. Now, 1 week passed. It's in the last few minutes of this 1 week. Now, Sukadeva Goswami was thinking that Parikshit Maharaj could be overwhelmed that he is going to die. That's why Sukadeva Goswami spoke this four kinds of destruction, four kinds of pralaya. Atyantika pralaya, nitya pralaya, naimittika pralaya, prakritika pralaya. So, in comparison to these great pralayas, the destruction of your body is so insignificant. Please understand this, my dear Parikshit Maharaj. You are going to die. Don't feel bad. This will happen. What about you are going to die. Means your one body is going to be burned by this snake. So, compare this with the destruction of the entire universe, destruction of all the planetary systems within the universe. Compare this with the constant deterioration of every material object in the material universe. So, compare, if you just remember this, you will understand that your own death is so insignificant event in this cosmic manifestation. So, don't take it very seriously. Absorb your mind in Krishna. Absorb your mind in the right understanding of the temporary nature of material body and eternal nature of spirit soul. So, now he says that just like fire is different from the fuel, similarly, the soul is different from the body. So, fire and fuel are different. Similarly, soul and body are different. And he says that the soul is distinct from the body. Soul is like an observer. Soul is actually unborn. Only body is born. The soul is eternal. Soul is immortal. Now, just like within a dream, one may see that one's head is cut off. So, if one's head is cut off, one cannot see himself. But if it is a dream, he can see that his head is being cut off and he will feel bad for it. So, why? Because of the identification with the material body. So, similarly, in this material world, we may suffer, just like the person who is in the dream, he is seeing his head being cut off and he is suffering. Similarly, the conditioned soul in this material world undergoes a lot of material miseries and he suffers. But if the person who is sleeping comes out of the dream and understands that that's only a dream, it's not reality, then there is no suffering. Similarly, the spirit soul, when he is awakened to his spiritual consciousness and does not identify with the material body in this material world, which is like a dreamy situation, then the spirit soul also will not suffer. So, don't identify with this material body. Whatever may happen to the material body happens by destiny, by fate, by the will of the Lord. So, you just have to surrender to the situation and focus on the Supreme Lord. So, that like that, there are so many other aspects in this series of shlokas. He also gives another example. Sky is the unchanging background. So, clouds keep changing. If you see the sky is the permanent or constant background for the clouds. clouds keep on changing. They will become big, they will become small, they will move from here and there, they will change their shapes, but the sky is constantly there. Similarly, the soul is eternal and the material bodies keep on changing. So now Parikshit is undergoing a change of body. Okay. So this Takshaka snake is going to come and bite Parikshit Maharaj, and Parikshit will die, apparently, to the vision of the materialistic person. But Sukadeva Goswami is saying that you are not this body. You are a spirit soul. You are an eternal servant of the Supreme Lord Krishna. So Sukadeva Goswami is inspiring Parikshit Maharaj to be absorbed in that knowledge. So towards the end of his life, then Takshaka will not burn your true self. Takshaka will burn only your body. So you have conquered all the obstacles or dangers on the path back to Godhead. So now what more you want to hear? You tell me now. Then that completes the fifth chapter. And Parikshit Maharaj would profusely thank Sukadeva Goswami. My dear Sukadeva Goswami, you have given me so much of knowledge. I have achieved the purpose of my life. I have no desires to hear anything more. So great souls show mercy to foolish conditioned souls. You are a great soul. So I have heard entire Srimad Bhagavatam that described the Supreme Lord, Uttama Shloka. So I have no fear of Takshaka. Let that Takshaka come and bite. I have no fear. Sukadeva Goswami spoke entire Bhagavatam, and now Parikshit Maharaj is saying that I have no fear of Takshaka. But if you remember, so Parikshit Maharaj spoke that he had no fear of Takshaka even before he met Sukadeva Goswami also. Tammopayatam pratiyantu vipra gangacha devi dhritachittamisha. In that shloka, Parikshit Maharaj said that whatever magical thing or bird or snake that the Brahmana must have created to kill me, let it come and bite me. I have absolutely no fears. Gayatha Vishnu Gatha. I just want to hear the descriptions of Lord Vishnu from all of you Brahmanas. He says like that. That's in, I think, 18.15, I think. So in that only he said, Parikshit Maharaj said. So now he's saying, Parikshit Maharaj, you revealed the supreme personal feature of the Lord. I am now fixed in the knowledge and self-realization. So Sukadeva Goswami blessed Parikshit Maharaj. He got up from his seat and then he just left. He did not wait to see Parikshit Maharaj being bitten by the snake or, departure. So Sukadeva Goswami, being such a detached renunciant, he just spoke Srimad Bhagavatam for 1 week in front of Parikshit Maharaj, and he departed. And Parikshit Maharaj meditated on the Supreme Lord. He is absorbed in meditation on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He sat in a darbha seat. So meanwhile, Takshaka, the Takshaka snake bird, started making his way towards Parikshit Maharaj. On the way, Takshaka met Kashyapa. So then Takshaka spoke to Kashyapa and flattered Kashyapa with some sweet words, and then diverted his attention. And then this Takshaka came in the form of a Brahmana, and then came in front of Parikshit Maharaj, and then bit Parikshit Maharaj. You can see that picture. So Takshaka was biting Parikshit Maharaj, the snake bird, and Parikshit Maharaj's body was burned to ashes by the fire of snake's poison. So there was a terrible cry all over the universe, and even Gandharvas and Apsaras started singing, and the demigods in joy showered flowers, because they understand that only Parikshit Maharaj's body is being burned, and this departure of Parikshit Maharaj is such a glorious departure. So now, after this incident, there is another peculiar incident. So Parikshit Maharaj left his body. So he went back to the spiritual world. So in the 18th chapter of first canto, fourth shloka, the sages of Naimisharanya spoke to Suta Goswami. Na uttama shloka vartanam jushatam tatkathamrutam syat sambharamontakalepi smaratam tatpadambujam. Na uttama shloka vartanam jushatam tatkathamrutam means the person who has absorbed his mind and words and thoughts and actions in glorifying the Supreme Lord's qualities and rendering services to him, such a person will not run into any misconceptions even at the time of death. So, nauttama shloka vartanam jushatam tat kathamritam syat sambharamo antakalepi. Antakala means at the end of one's life. Syat sambharamo, he will not have any sambharama, means misconception or bewilderment or confusion. Generally, a person who is about to die, he feels lot of physical pain and also mental pain. He would be meditating on all unfulfilled desires. He would be meditating, what will happen to my property, what will happen to my family members, what will happen to my grandchildren, or what will happen to my shares, so where will I so that kind of anxieties overwhelm the person. They will beg the doctor, so please allow me to live for 10 more days. Please allow me to live for 6 more months so that I can see the marriage of my granddaughter and then depart. Or let me witness the birth of my grandchild and then depart. Let me just complete this responsibility, that responsibility. So they keep on meditating on unfulfilled desires, a typical materialistic person. But one who has lived a life of absorption in Krishna, one who has rendered service to Krishna and heard Krishna katha throughout one's life, such a person can easily remember Krishna's lotus feet at the time of death. Smaratam tat padambujam. So, Sukadeva Goswami left and Parikshit Maharaj was bitten by Takshaka, and Parikshit Maharaj went back to Godhead naturally because he was remembering Krishna, although this snake bit him when he was alive. We have seen in the 6th canto, Vritrasur was fighting with Indra, and Indra took his thunderbolt and he was just trying to cut the throat of Vritrasur for one full year, but Vritrasur did not even perceive that pain. He was absorbed in samadhi, he was meditating on Lord Sankarsana. And Dadhichi offered his bones to the demigods. So the demigods were collecting Dadhichi's bones, means Dadhichi has to die. He has to be separated from this body. But Dadhichi did not even realize that he is being separated from his body because Dadhichi was absorbed in meditation on Krishna. So one can transcend physical pain also when the mind is totally absorbed in the Supreme Lord. Parikshit Maharaj went back to spiritual world in this way. So after this, Parikshit Maharaj's son Janamejaya conducted a great sacrifice. He was thinking that this snake Takshaka killed my father Parikshit, I will kill all the snakes. So Parikshit Janamejaya organized a great sacrifice. So in that sacrifice, he invoked the presence of so many snakes in this universe, and he's just throwing all the snakes into the sacrificial fire. So he's invoking the presence of all the snakes. So many snakes were getting killed. Now Takshaka went and took shelter of Indra. Then Indra gave shelter. Okay. Then Janamejaya asked the priests, why Takshaka is not coming? He is the one who killed my father. So many other snakes are coming. Then the priest said that Takshaka has taken shelter of Indra. Then Janamejaya said that, okay, chant mantras and throw Indra also into the fire. Then Brihaspati immediately manifested there in front of Janamejaya. He said that, my dear Janamejaya, why are you conducting this sacrifice? It is there within your father's fate or destiny to be killed by Takshaka. So you cannot consider anyone as the cause of your happiness or distress or death or birth. So everybody undergoes certain experiences in one's life by one's own activities. So one should take responsibility for those activities. One should not unnecessarily blame others or harm others that they are the cause of my suffering. Now one snake killed your father, that does not mean you kill all the snakes in the entire creation. Please understand this philosophy that nothing can happen without the sanction of the Supreme Lord. Please understand this fact. Same thing is told by Swayambhu Manu to Dhruva also. So Dhruva's brother Uttama was killed by Yaksha. So Dhruva went to Alakapuri, fought with Yakshas. At one point he was trying to annihilate the entire race of Yakshas. Then Swayambhu Manu came and told, for one person's mistake, you want to kill the entire dynasty. Janamejaya also is doing the same thing. One person, one snake killed his father, he's trying to kill all the snakes. So for one person's mistake, one should not inhalate or one should not condemn the entire race. That's not approved by great sages or Srimad Bhagavatam. Now for instance, Parikshit Maharaj, Janamayaji's own father, Parikshit Maharaj was cursed by one Brahmana boy, that is Sringi. Did Parikshit Maharaj condemn entire Brahmana race? No, he has taken shelter of another Brahmana, Sukadev Goswami, and he has heard Bhagavatam from Sukadev Goswami for 7 days, and he respected other Brahmanas like Vyasadeva and Naradamuni. He did not condemn all the Brahmanas, but Janamejaya, who is the son of Parikshit Maharaj, he condemned all the snakes. So sometimes we may go into extremes, and we may condemn the entire race or community or family or a dynasty for one person's mistake in that group. But that is not allowed in Srimad Bhagavatam. And we have seen in the fourth canto of Bhagavatam also that Daksha cursed Shiva. And Shiva's assistant Nandi, he cursed not only Daksha, he started criticizing and cursing all the supporters and followers of Daksha. And that angered Bhrugu. Then Bhrugu started cursing all the followers of Lord Shiva. So like that, for one person's mistake, one may get into extremes and then they start condemning the entire race or community, which is not very much appreciated within the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam. But one good thing in a devotee is that a devotee restrains himself. Although circumstantially a devotee does a mistake, for example, Janamejaya was too much into emotional outburst. So Janamejaya was thinking of killing all the snakes. He went into extremes. But when Brihaspati came and gave him good counsel, Janamejaya immediately stopped the sacrifice. Similarly, Dhruva, he was trying to kill all the yakshas, but when Swayambhumanu gave him good advice, he stopped. Sometimes devotees may circumstantially or accidentally may do some mistakes, but when they are advised by other exalted devotees, they will restrain themselves from such behavior. So that's one good thing in devotees. So that's why we should always be in the association of devotees, so that when we become sometimes emotional or take some extreme step, then other devotees can come and control us and give us good advice and take us back in proper direction. So that's another incident that is described. So that completes the discussion between Sukadeva Goswami and Parikshit Maharaj. Now, this conversation is being quoted by Suta Goswami in front of the sages of Naimisharanya. Now we will go into the outer loop. What happened between sages of Naimisharanya and Suta Goswami? So we completed half of 6th chapter. So we will continue the 6th chapter in the next episode. So from there, we'll have other sections to follow. So thank you all very much. Granthara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.